Welcome, everybody, to the second half kickoff. And this show has really morphed into exactly what we wanted it to be. And that is daytime sports with our friends, talking, having coffee. And we've got Les Lazaruk, the voice of the Saskatoon Blades, here in the bunker. And all of you, of course. Les, you are you coffeed out? You didn't want coffee? What's the deal?
I'm coffeed out. I've been up since 6.
What?
And I've had more than enough coffee. This is a busy day today because I'm still doing sportscast for CJWW, my employer, the Saskatoon Media Group back home. So there's casts to do. There's all kinds of little features to do, features that I do every day. I do a daily sports commentary called The Parting Shot. There's a Blades feature that has to go on an FM station. So there's a lot to do. And if I was going to fit this in along with two other podcasts that I'm involved with today.
Yeah.
There's not enough hours in the day sometimes. People think I'm in Regina having a holiday. There's no holiday here, folks. This is not a holiday. And you know what, though, Rod? I'm not complaining. I love it. The fact that I'm back doing what I love to do, this is phenomenal right
Western
now.
Hockey League is playing.
Yes.
And that's very exciting. So, hey, one thing. Mm-hmm. Watching in Philadelphia right now, Dan, the situation, Saravelli is watching from the Enterprise Sports Show.
Okay.
And he says, Rod, I see your bracket's still alive. I don't know what to say about that. You know, all of 2 minutes thought went into my bracket at CBSSports.com. Thank you, Dan, the situation, Saravelli, for inviting me into that bracket in Philly. And I'm glad to see that it is still alive. Go Oral Roberts. Well, I know they fell to Florida, but it's still... No, they won.
Yeah, they did.
Oral's still going.
They're still going. They're in the Sweet 16.
Breaking news today. The Toronto Raptors here on this NBA trade deadline have dealt Norman Powell to the Portland Trailblazers for guards Rodney Hood and Gary Trent Jr. So the fire sale's begun. Norman Powell gone, which is unfortunate. And I guess we wait until 2 p.m. No, 1 p.m.
1 p.m.
Mountain, our time, for the actual NBA trade deadline. But as was pointed out by the Canadian press earlier, those trades, it's like the dub. They won't, just because the deadline passes doesn't necessarily mean they'll even be announced. Paperwork needs to be done.
Yep.
So we won't know necessarily by 1 o'clock p.m. Mountain where we are situated if Kyle Lowry remains a Raptor past today or not. But this is the golden corral of sports talk, and that is we have a little bit for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to get into officiating our junior A scoop. I just want to say this. There's a big talk going about the CFL, the 20% pay cuts. And listen, I can take it. There's players that are coming at me that are saying, I'm saying you don't have any options, guys. You either have to accept this pay cut and play or retire. Those are your options. And they're saying, we know that's our options. We don't like it, Rut.
Hmm.
Don't come at me, guys. I'm not the bad guy.
No.
You need to accept that this is where you're at. And I know that you're in a pinch. And I don't like what the owners are doing. I don't. And so from our viewers here, Jason in Red Deer says, I don't mind the truth. If the league has to cease after efforts to revive, then so be it. But I don't feel the league is even trying anymore. Well, that's a nice cavalier attitude for people to say, oh, the league will fold, they'll come back. What about these players? That's the point. I think they're realizing that they don't hold the power that they thought they did.
Well, and not just the players having the issue of not being able to play and maybe having to retire, but don't be so cavalier. Just because it's going to work in Saskatchewan coming back, just because it's going to work in Winnipeg coming back, or in Hamilton... Some places, it's not going to come back. It may not come back in Toronto. It may not come back in Vancouver. It may not come back in Montreal. Because those are the types of cosmopolitan types of centers in Canada that the CFL has a very tenuous situation with. Because there's enough people, and you've talked about this, I've known this for a long time, the National Football League is that large conglomerate that has just absolutely consumed us. You can gamble on just about everything. You can watch 9,000 different games, as opposed to the CFL, where you've only got 9 teams, and the gambling options are limited. And as a result, people don't care as much about the CFL as they should in this country. They're overly consumed by the National Football League, and it's too bad.
The NFL's Costco.
Yeah, it is.
And it's caused the shutdown of the corner store.
Absolutely.
From Chris Bird in Toronto, he says, I'm sure the league is trying.
Yep.
But the league needs 9 governors on board. Not so sure that's happening. Plus, the league reportedly, and not surprisingly, has no money. Jim Waldron says, so I guess Boomer was right about the CFL. Since you guys can't seem to get it up and running, I mean, maybe it's time to become a minor league to the NFL. They could save you. Look at their TV deal. Simple way is to open up the import rule. Jim Waldron is a viewer in New Jersey, by the way. And yes, I've only been saying this for 20 years, and I'm the jerk. The CFL people are vehemently opposed to being an NFL farm league or a partner with the XFL, and it's going to be to their detriment. One more from Dan, the situation, Saravelli, who says Kyle Lowry likely could end up in Philly. How about that? Maybe just a rental player. Yeah, till the end of the year. Then he goes back to Toronto. That would work.
That would work. How about the LA Lakers? How about the Miami Heat? Those are the three teams that are being mentioned this morning as possible destinations for Kyle Lowry.
Wow.
Does it have to happen? Just the fact that they traded Norman Powell now and got two people back, do they necessarily now absolutely have to trade Kyle Lowry? Something to consider.
You know, and it's always great how we sprinkle in the viewers, right? Mike Soulier, trainer to the stars. Hockey, football, and gosh knows what else. He says, Sewells is listening.
Yes.
And Ken Hitchcock's best friend. I'm going to throw that in there right there, Mike Soulier.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was a close friend of my dad's. So nice segue to hockey, Lester.
Okay.
Before we get to the dub stuff. And then Bill Chow coming in next segment. Les is going to stick around for a portion of that, I hope. I've mentioned that the BC Hockey League breaking off from the Canadian Junior Hockey League, the umbrella organization that oversees all of Junior A hockey and Hockey Canada, they're going to do their own thing. Four teams from Alberta reportedly joining them. I'm told Brooks, Okotoks, Spruce Grove, and Grand Prairie. That's our breaking news today. I'm not going to ask you about that.
No.
What I am going to ask you about is Tim Peel.
Mm-hmm.
And how you feel this referee that, I guess if the NHL doesn't want to say that they fired him, even though they did, can we at least say you've suspended him? Because you have.
Yes.
How do you feel about the treatment of him and what went down?
I don't like it. I don't like the fact that an open mic caught what Tim Peel did. He essentially did what pretty much the National Hockey League asks its officials to do. It has been forever. My favorite saying is, at the end of a game, when you start taking a look at the power play chances that each team has, is that the officials somehow found a way to have the same number of marbles in each of their pockets. Essentially the same number of power plays for each team. And it always seems to end up that way. There are even up calls, whether you want to admit it or not. And there's situations where if a team gets up a couple of goals early, the officials seem almost like they need to give the team that's trailing an opportunity with a manpower advantage off a little bit of a chintzy call, a little bit of a call that is not that great, in order to give them a chance to maybe score on the power play and get back into the game, to maintain the competitiveness of the individual games. Because otherwise, especially back in the 80s, if you didn't do that, and it's continued since then, but back in the 80s when there was such a disparity between the great Oilers teams and some of those others, like the Islanders, etc., and then you had the dregs at the bottom, like my Winnipeg at times, you would have the blowouts. If you didn't give those inferior teams an opportunity at some point to get back into the game, you were going to lose fans and the competition aspect. So there's so much parity now that you really don't need to do it, but it's still ingrained in the NHL's officiating, and that's why it happens. And what Tim Peel did is essentially what his bosses at the National Hockey League want him to do.
And turn it around and fired him for it.
And turn around and fired him for it. And I hope that they rescind it. I hope they let him get out on his own terms and do a couple of games. Although if I'm Tim Peel, I'd probably tell him to go stuff it. You know, you can take your job and stuff it. I mean, I'm retired now. I was going to retire in a month. But I would like to see him go out with a little more of an opportunity to do one last game and get the proper goodbye that he deserves.
Well, he's not going to get it, Les.
No,
and here's what's going to happen, by the way. I've done a dinner within the last couple of years with Don Koharski, along with Chris Nyland and Zenon Park, and it was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Mick Magoo, doing all those banquets with Mick, he opened the door for me to that officiating world. And I was as devastated as anybody outside of his family when he passed prematurely, because we were just getting rolling. Stephen Wacom, all those guys, it's a great world, that officiating world.
Mm-hmm.
And they're getting screwed over here. Tim Peel is.
Absolutely.
And here's what's going to happen is he's going to maybe go out, if he's that kind of guy, and go to these banquets and stuff, and everybody's going to say, man, you really got screwed, Tim. He's like, oh, I know. You know what I mean? They're never going to get over this.
Mm.
This is his legacy now, and shame on the National Hockey. It is. I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah.
He will be Tim Peeled. This is how he's going to be remembered.
Yeah.
So I'm I'm with you. My question to Dave Poulin, like last hour, was how do they officiate games moving forward? That competitive aspect still going to go on. Makeup calls are still going to go on.
Yep.
And we can all see that they're going on. Yep. So are the coaches not allowed to say it? Are the broadcasters not allowed to say it? What are you going to do now, NHL? But we're moving on because it's a fast-paced show.
Yes.
Drew Koser writes in from the Off the Hosel podcast. You
yes.
know Drew from,
I knew.
Drew from the hockey-playing Koser family.
Yes.
He says, Les's thoughts on Roddy Ross.
Disappointing, unfortunately, for him, because we're talking about a kid who's in
this
his last year.
This is a 20-year-old Regina Pats goalie that came from the
exactly.
Seattle Thunderbirds and is a prospect of the Philadelphia Flyers.
Exactly.
Sorry.
No, that's fine. And I was actually going to bring that up. The fact that you're bringing in a kid who was a 20-year-old who was the reason why the Seattle Thunderbirds did as well as they did last year. He stole games for the Thunderbirds last year. We haven't seen that, unfortunately, from Roddy Ross so far. And people may say, well, why doesn't Dave Struce make the move and put in Matthew Keeper and let him take the ball and run with it for a while? Because we still haven't heard for sure whether there's going to be a playoff or not in the Western Hockey League. Until such time as that is said to be not on the table, you're going to go with the people that you think give you the best opportunity to win games. And as a result, Dave Struce still believes, along with John Paddock, I'm sure, that Roddy Ross can find his game and gives the Regina Pats the best opportunity to win more often than not in this double. So Roddy Ross will have to work his way out of it, just like Carey Price had to work his way out of it for the Montreal Canadiens earlier in the season. Roddy Ross, I'm sure, will do it. He's liable to do it tomorrow when the Blades take on the Pats and just absolutely stone Saskatoon. That's the way hockey goes, and I think you have to give Roddy Ross the opportunity.
Nice. Glenn Erickson watching from Dub Network.
Mm.
He's in Medicine Hat. He says, I love the officiating fraternity. So many great guys, so many great stories. With this in mind, Sweet Knox left us this past week. Rest in peace. Yeah. From Janelle Barkman in Saskatoon, she says, two of my favorite guys talking sports. Love the opinions, love the insight. Thank you, Janelle. Love you too.
Absolutely.
Go Blades!
Yep, absolutely.
You beat my Pats the other day, Les. Nick writes in. Nick on Twitter, I don't know his last name, he says, following up the report from the Rod Pedersen Show that the BCHL potentially leaving Canadian junior hockey and taking four Alberta teams to form a new league, a BCHL spokesperson said today, quote, we've seen these reports and we can't make any comment on it at the moment.
No surprise. That's going to happen.
From Travis Rosebrook, he says, I think the refs need to make the call and move on from it. We all make mistakes. There's no need to keep track of what they got right and wrong. Makeup calls are like me losing game 7 of the cup finals at NHL 21 and turning off the game and restarting it so I can win. I guess so. But let me just say this. You want to talk about you're suspending Tim Peel to preserve the integrity of the game and the National Hockey League. No, you're not. This is where you screwed up, NHL.
Yeah.
Because you're burying the secret of what goes on in games.
Exactly.
Unless you fix that secret, it's always going to be a problem. So if you're saying that makeup calls hurt integrity of the game, then get rid of them. Don't get rid of the guy that admitted that you were doing it.
And they can't not unearth the secret and bring it to light, because if you start doing that and then you start calling every penalty, and you see it every year at the beginning of the year.
Yep.
You call everything in the exhibition season and early in the year, and you end up with 30 power plays a night, and it slows down the flow of the game. There is no flow to the game, and nobody likes it. So this is essentially what you get. There is the secret. There's the way things are done, and they're done this way in order to maintain the competitive balance, to provide entertainment, to provide flow to the game, and that's the way it is. The fact that the NHL did this to Tim Peel is so not right. It's ridiculous.
Dean Shaw writes in. He says, I always listen to you on the airwaves, but first time listener to this format. Now I know what I'm missing. Great job. Thank you, Dean. I appreciate you watching and commenting and listening. And I'll just say one more before I just turn for one last point with Les. Brent Sopel.
Yeah.
Whom I love.
Great man.
Wrote in yesterday from Florida, Clearwater, Florida. Stanley Cup champion, former Saskatoon Blade.
Yes, he was.
I like how I always say that.
I like that.
He said, how about Colin Campbell continually emailing Stephen Wacom, bitching about calls on his kid when Colin Campbell was playing for the Boston Bruins? Like, Soaps is basically saying, who's Colin Campbell to talk about integrity? He was all over Stephen Wacom.
Mm-hmm.
because of the way he officiated his kid. So, like, it's bad. If this guy's making the call on firing Tim Peel, it's inexcusable. Lastly, and then I will let you go, and we'll bring in Bill Chow, but Lester, your take on the future of the Canadian Football League right now. XFL merger, an all-Canadian CFL, or will there even be a CFL? Where are you on this?
Well, I fear for the CFL. The fact that they didn't play last year was concerning to me. I felt they needed to at least give it a try, and they didn't do it. I understand there's no money in it. There's no revenue in it. The teams can't afford to do it. I think there's some owners that could have. I think there's some owners that probably could have anteed up and made sure it happened, because I think you need to keep yourself in the public eye. This is the biggest thing that I think the Western Hockey League, that the Quebec Major Junior League, that these leagues have done, even though they're going to take a bit of a bath financially, is the fact that they've put their product out there and kept themselves in the public eye. The CFL, if it doesn't get started this year in some way, shape, or form, might very well be sounding the death knell. And I hate to say that because I love the CFL. I'm a kid that grew up in Winnipeg and got on my bike and drove a few miles in order to get tickets in the Salisbury House kids section in the south end zone of the old Winnipeg Stadium. I love the CFL, but they're just not seeing what they have to do in order to keep themselves alive. If it means pairing up with the XFL, fine. I don't like that. I prefer to see the Canadian Football League still be a place where Canadian university and junior athletes can come out and still play professionally. But I don't know if that's going to be feasible down the line with the way the situation is right now.
Well said.
Thank you.
Doesn't look good.
Doesn't look good.
Listen, I'm going to let you roll.
Yeah.
So thanks for popping in.
Not a problem. Any old time. I'm here till the 28th of April or so.
Isn't it great?
It's wonderful. I can't tell you. I mean, I got a text from Cam Moon at the end of last night's game. What a game that was, where the Blades were able to score twice in the final 3.5 minutes and then win it in overtime. And just the fact that I can do what I love and the passion that I love to show for the game, the fact that the game is back. Roddy, I'll be easily admitting to you that December and January were not a lot of fun mentally. I was down. It was tough to get going on a day-to-day basis, writing and talking about COVID on newscasts in the radio station. This has brought me back.
Good to hear, Les, and good to have you.
Thank you.
Bill Chow, the president of the Saskatchewan Junior Hockey League. Next, you're watching the RP Show on Game Plus TV, YouTube and Facebook Live, and listen live. 24-hour sports talk for Suds Full Service Car Wash at rodpedersen.com.
You're watching Rod Pedersen On Demand. For more of the Rod Pedersen Show, visit rodpedersen.com or follow Rod Pedersen on social media.